Hey YouTube, I'm Robert Hall and I recently switched to Sony, so I'm gonna tell you why I made the decision and the things that I like and dislike about my switch to Sony. If you end up enjoying this video, please hit that like button before you leave. It really helps me out. And if you'd like to see more of my videos, consider subscribing. So I know I talked to you guys in the past about switching to mirrorless, how I thought eventually at some point I'd get into a mirrorless system. And I tried it before with the Fuji X-T2. I tried it before with the Sony A6000. I tried it before with the Olympus EM5 Mark II. Been down this road many times, but finally I'm going all in 100% on mirrorless for both my photo and my video needs. Here's what I like and don't like about switching to the Sony a7 R3. First off, the quality. I don't think anyone has a doubt about the quality of the a7 R3. I mean, we all know that it's got one of the highest dynamic ranges out there. We all know it has 42 megapixels, that's crazy. But what I was shocked by with quality is the high ISO performance. I did not expect this out of this high megapixel of a body, but man, I can push this thing up to 25,600 ISO and my images still look really clean. I still feel like I might be able to push it and go even higher in ISO in what I deliver to a client. Number two is the EVF, or electronic viewfinder. If you don't know, this is probably the biggest draw to switching to mirrorless. The EVF shows you how your settings will apply to your image in real time through the viewfinder, which is just insanely powerful for quickly dialing in your shot however you want it to look. Really allows you to just focus on the content of your image and just ignore that meter altogether. It's really good for creative effects too, because you can quickly make adjustments just to see how something will look. So if you want to try a silhouette, or if you want to try shifting the white balance of the ambient temperature in a room before you add in flash, like, you can see how all those adjustments will apply to your ambient before you start mixing in other things. Number three is having a more functional live view. Now, live view is something that I started using a bit more on my Nikon D750 because it has the same application as an EVF in that you can preview your settings. Unfortunately, with Nikon, the autofocus just doesn't work well in live view, at least on like the Nikon D750, which is the last camera that I had for Nikon. And trying to move the focus point around is extremely slow, whether you're manually focusing and you want to zoom in, or you're actually trying to autofocus with it. It's just terrible performance. Now, by using a mirrorless camera, the live view is essentially the exact same performance that you get out of looking through the viewfinder, which just makes it easier whether you're doing things at different angles, or you want to have that big screen and you want to zoom in. And that experience is just way better when you don't lose any performance by switching into live view. Number four, autofocus in general, but I'm gonna break it down in a few different ways. So the first way is the AF area. On a Nikon D750, the autofocus area, the amount of space that you can actually autofocus in, is absolutely tiny. I mean, on the D750, you can't even get to like the top third or bottom third of the frame to where you'd want to compose a subject. You have to actually focus and recompose, which I hate doing because it decreases the accuracy of your autofocus. Now with mirrorless, you're not limited to that tiny little central area. So this has been amazing because it really opens up my compositions without having to focus and recompose. Now on the A7 R3 as well as the A9, Sony finally has an AF selector. I wasn't buying a Sony body until they had a dedicated AF selector because it's just completely necessary to how I shoot, because I always pick my point. I want to choose the area in my image that I'm focusing on in every single image. Now, accuracy and speed, that was somewhere that previous cameras fell short. The Sony A9 was the first camera I used that I felt like, okay, mirrorless focus is here. Like, it's truly equal, if not better, than some DSLRs. And that's true on the A7 R2. They borrowed a majority of the focus points and the focusing system of the A9, and it's just a fantastic experience focusing with this. My first wedding using the A7 R, I was at one of the darkest venues that is in the Metro Detroit area, especially where everybody walks down the aisle during the ceremony. I'm not gonna lie to you guys, I had my D750 and my 70-200 packed away because I was so concerned about how the Sony would perform in that situation. People walking towards you in low light, that is the most nightmarish autofocus situation, and I just didn't know how this was gonna perform. So I kind of tested it out with one of the videographers in advance and just had no issues whatsoever. The ambient settings of this room, if I wanted to properly expose with ambient lighting, it would have been 1/125th, f2.8, ISO 51,000. That's what it would take to just shoot ambient in there. Now, I did use flash for the processional just to get cleaner images, but just so you know, the environment that I succeeded focusing in was super, super dark. And throughout the rest of the day, the speed and the accuracy performed absolutely fine. I didn't feel hindered at all. In some cases, I felt that it was actually a little bit better than my D750, specifically with tracking subjects. I feel like it's just a nicer experience on this camera. And finally, that brings me to eye autofocus. Eye autofocus for weddings and portraits is just so nice. You get the focus point somewhere close to your subject's face, tap the eye, and boom, you're tracking that eye. You don't have to move the point around a ton to follow them, even as your subjects move. That's been really beneficial in my shooting, especially when I'm using a really shallow depth of field and I'm trying to let my couple have fun. I'm trying to let them move and play around with each other. That eye autofocus to just track that eye as it moves around and you can move around too a little bit. Man, it just makes shooting portraits a blast. So finally, with mirrorless, I feel like I'm giving up nothing when it comes to autofocus. I'm truly impressed with the A7 R3 in this regard. Point number five is control customization. The level of customization on the A7 R3 is just ridiculous. I think you get four custom buttons, four C buttons, and you can program those to like any of 20 pages of functions. And you can apply those custom functions, like one set for photos, one set for playback, one set for video. So you can modify what those controls do in different shooting functions. And there's even some buttons that you can modify, like on the D-pad or your press of your AF selector, your AF on button. You can modify what all those do too. So one thing I did, because I'm a back button focuser, I made my AF selector, when I press it down, that's my AF on button. So my finger never leaves that button for typical autofocus. I know it's like this tiny millisecond between moving your thumb from button to button. It's just that little bit faster and it gives you the edge to attack photos a little bit quicker, which is huge for wedding photography. Dual card slots, finally. This was the reason that I avoided Sony for so long, was because they just didn't have dual card slots. And again, A9 didn't really suit my style. Absolute necessity for a wedding photographer, because I need to be recording to both card slots the whole day. Now, one thing I don't like is like the mixed speeds. Like, why they don't just put two UHS-II compatible slots in there? I don't know, because it's annoying for both video and for photo that the second card is a reduced speed, because it's just going to take longer to write any images or videos to it. But the important part is that images get to two card slots all the time. So I'm really happy that they included those two slots on the A7 R3. Next up is video features, and this is where my previous experience with the Fuji X-T2 fell short. I just did not like that body for video. It didn't have the in-body image stabilization. I wasn't a fan of how everything was set up for video, and really I didn't like how the screen looked, especially for zooming in, which is something that the Sony kind of suffers from too. Now, I'm sure that the A7S III, whenever that comes out, that's going to be a better body for videographers, but this has everything that I need in terms of video features. It has awesome 4K, it has awesome peaking, it has killer in-body image stabilization. All those features just make it do everything I need for video purposes. And lastly, the quiet shutter. On my Nikon D750, the slap of the mechanical shutter was just really obtrusive. Like, I thought it stuck out like a sore thumb, especially when I was in a quiet place like a wedding ceremony. Now, the A7 R3, it's a little bit quieter, which has been a nice benefit for me, but I also have the option of shooting completely silent. Now, this comes with a caveat, because it's using the electronic shutter. If you're interested to know more about using a mechanical shutter versus an electronic shutter, you can watch this video here. And the A7 R3 is certainly nothing like the Sony A9, which is designed to have a really fast readout that alleviates most of the problems that you get from using an electronic shutter. So with the A7 R3, you have to pick the times that you're using the electronic shutter really carefully, because you can't be doing any panning. But if you're in good light and you're shooting mostly stable subjects, then using the electronic shutter is a completely silent experience, and you're not putting any wear on the actual camera. This last point isn't a pro or a con, it's more so of just a discussion, because it doesn't affect me, but it is a negative of the Sony platform. So for me, Sony has all the lenses that I need. I went with 12-24, 24-70, 70-200, 50-85. I adapted my tilt shift and my macro, because both those lenses are manual focus anyway, so rather than sell them and buy different solutions, I just adapted them since I didn't lose any features. The only lens I haven't added that I do want is a 35mm 1.4. I'm basically just waiting to sell some Nikon gear before I actually make that purchase. So for me, as a wedding and portrait photographer, all my lenses are covered. But I certainly understand the criticism that Sony just doesn't have a full landscape of lenses yet. I have their budget, like $250 50mm 1.8, but that thing is terrible. I don't like that lens at all. It's loud. It feels like it's from like 2001. I can't believe that that's a modern lens. It can't be that difficult to have a decent 50mm 1.4 that isn't $1,400. Every other company does it. Can't be that difficult to have a 51.8 that isn't terrible for under $1,000. They've shown that they can do it with the 85mm 1.8, and I just hope we see more lenses like that, especially primes. Okay, so that covers my open discussion and everything that I do like, so what don't I like? The first thing is the 42 megapixels. I'm really not in love with it, but I think this is like 20% Sony and 80% Adobe, because processing those 42 megapixel files in Lightroom is just an absolute chore, especially for wedding work, the high volume. There's no medium raw option, so that's really difficult. I'm exploring Capture One now, and it's a much better experience going through the images on that. I actually feel like I get the performance that I paid for out of my computer when I'm using Capture One. But thinking back, I maybe should have waited around for like an A7 III that might have been 24 to 30 megapixels. But I'm sure there'll be times where I love the megapixels for the cropping, and the A7 III isn't out yet, so here we are. The next thing I didn't like is that I didn't save any weight. I mean, in switching to this system, is just as bulky and heavy as a D750 full frame setup. The only way you're gonna save weight by switching to full frame mirrorless is if you're coming from a full size body like a Nikon D5 or a Canon 1DX Mark II. Otherwise, it's just as big. Now, I will say, previous Sony cameras were way too small for me to use all day, and I really like that larger grip that they made to hold the larger battery in the A7 R3. I can actually use it without a grip, even with lenses like the 70-200. So I really like that bigger grip size. Next thing I didn't like was the system cost. I already mentioned this with the lenses, but man, it costs a ton of money to get into this system. And at first, I was a little bit bummed by how much I lost by selling all my Nikon gear and switching to Sony. I still don't have all the equivalent lenses that I do, and I'm way more invested in Sony than I ever was with Nikon. But I crunched some numbers, and if I were to get two new D850s and their newest 24-70 and their newest 70-200, and the 14-24 is probably going to be replaced in the next year. If I were to buy all that stuff new for Nikon, it really wouldn't have been any difference in cost than buying Sony. So the final thought on that is, yes, my wallet hurts. No, I'm not disappointed in how much I paid for this gear. Next thing I don't like is the AF on button. This is part of the reason that I actually switched it to that press, is because the AF on button is like really flush with the body and tiny. Now the AF on button is more important to me than the button to click the photo, because I press that AF on button sometimes multiple times for every single image that I take. I feel like that AF on button needs to be out a little bit further, maybe a little bit larger, just more present for me to access. Next, why didn't they put a flip out screen on this? Flip out screen, all the things, please. Lastly, random quirks. I think this is a byproduct of the excessive amount of customization, but sometimes when you get into certain options being present and you're applying your custom buttons, like, things just get a little bit wonky. There were a few times where when I was pressing the center AF selector, which I have set to AF on, where my camera just didn't seem to know that that's what I wanted it to do. Like, it just ignored my custom option. It happened like 3 moments in the day, very briefly, but I think they have some work to do in the firmware just to clear up all of that customization and make sure that it works functionally with other features. There's also a few simple things, especially on the video side, that I'm really surprised that they haven't addressed yet. Max Yuryev just did a video that pretty much pointed out all the same things that I was thinking. So if you want to check that out, I've got that linked in the description below. So that's my piece on the Sony Switch at the moment. I'll definitely update you guys in the future as I make other gear switches. I want to let you guys know in advance, I do not plan on being another Sony hype beast or this channel pivoting to only Sony content. No plans to do that. I really don't even plan on doing any dedicated reviews on this equipment, but there were a lot of you that were interested on my mirrorless journey, so I figured I'd update you guys on where I am with that. Expect to see a Sony in my hands when we get back into the spring and I start doing more BTS and technique-based videos. The one thing I want to say about mirrorless, if you haven't tried it yet, there's definitely mirrorless gear out there that is competing with the DSLR. Mirrorless is not this step-down product that gives you EVF benefits anymore. It's certainly like a level playing field. So if you haven't gone out and played with one, check it out. Because once you get used to shooting with an EVF, just going back to a DSLR feels antiquated. The big reason why this stuck out in my head and I made this switch is because I shot 3 weeks in Thailand shooting on an A6500, seeing those live adjustments all the time, both in the viewfinder and on the live view screen. Then I came back here, started shooting with my DSLR again, and I felt like, ugh, gotta pay attention to that meter again. It just feels so natural having that image refresh in your eye all the time. It's just a way more modern experience when shooting with a camera. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Got links to all my gear in the description if you wanna check that out. Leave a like if you enjoyed the video, subscribe if you wanna see more, comment with any questions, and you can always join my photography gear chat group on Facebook if you wanna chat with me and thousands of other photographers. Until next time, keep on shooting, YouTube.